Mesdames et messieurs, bonsoir.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening.
Je suis très heureux, bien sûr, de
it is my delight to be amongst you here and to take
monde,
part to this panel incertain, on the state of the world, an uncertain world,
un monde troublé,
a troublesome world.
I do believe that Thierry said it all
on this issue in his opening speech of the proceedings of this conference, and I would like to seize this opportunity to congratulate him as to the success of this 10th edition held here in the city of Marrakesh. My reading is going to be that of a Moroccan that belongs to three sectors, three spheres, the Arab Muslim world, the Euro-Mediterranean sphere, and the African sphere as well. And from those three spheres or standpoints, I am proposing a reading of three tendencies, first of which is related to our world of proximity, which knows a crisis, which is blocked, which is frozen. The Mediterranean, for a long time now, has become just a stopover. It has lost its radiance and it has lost its stability. For 10 years now, the situation has worsened. In the north, in Europe, 10 years of crisis, difficult moments, increasing unemployment, a lethargy in terms of growth, recrudescence of populism,
an almost a
crisis that affects the euro, altogether with the emergence of new problems having to do with the refugees, asylum seekers, terrorists, and all this having adverse effects on what we call the Euro-Mediterranean partnership.
And
which makes Europe turn its back to the neighboring countries from the south. In the south, it's even worse.
The
Palestinian issue, forgotten for two decades, keeps nurturing feelings of hopelessness and despair. During the last 10 years, there were useless interventions, frustrating Arab Spring, civil wars, interfaith wars with the uprise of dislocated status, compartmentalized Arab world, and the recrudescence of radicalization, which has been outsourced to Africa. Economies that are dominated by profit-making with adverse effect, not only economically speaking, but also in terms of the cultural, society, and political model. And at the same time, the absence of regional integration, and I am having here in mind our region, that of the Maghreb. All this has contributed to weakening even further our region. However, at the end of this year, there are some indicators of hope in the north. With the return of growth, it's very important for Europe, but it's also important for us. The renewal of the political sphere in France, one which is now up to adhere and become inscribed to the logic of reform. Hope indicators related to the renewal of the European project for Europe to become stronger, more coherent, more consistent with the speeches of Emmanuel Macron, but also with the due interest given by Mrs. Merkel to Africa. All this is quite important. It's even more important to also pay due attention to separatism and to draw teachings and lessons from the Catalan crisis. However, populism does have its limits. What is certain is that in the aftermath of Brexit, after Obama, that after the beginning of disengagement, it may be, it's certainly a chance, a great opportunity for Europe.
L'échec
du séparatisme
the failure of separatism is necessarily linked to political considerations, but also considerations that dovetail with the politics of European regionalization. In the South, there are hope indicators as well, and we get started by this glimpse of hope of reconciliation among Palestinians. It's also the failure of ISIS. We need to all remain and be cautious as to what's happened, what will happen afterwards. And as Cogenti pointed out by the ambassador, in Saudi Arabia, there is a wake-up call as to the necessity of making women's rights move forward, consecrating an Islam of tolerance while diversifying the production means and production resources, and Saudi Arabia will certainly embark on this with Asia after King Sultan of Saudi Arabia's trip to China and Japan. There is also
a prize
of the nationalist movement
against
the failure of separatism in Kurdistan that we need to take into consideration. We need to further rehabilitate our region and make it regain its centrality. The second tendency I would like to point out is the faraway world that calls upon us. We've been talking about Russia, its geopolitical return, but in Russia there is a hiatus between the qualitative and quantitative weakness of its economic model and its economics at large. The word that calls us from far away is that of Great Asia, namely that of China. In 35 years, China, a developing country, is becoming the second superpower of the world. But what matters most is that the China of today is no longer a workshop of global economy. It's a laboratory of green economy, of digital economy that comes right after the U.S. in this regard, and even because it has changed its economic model. What matters most is the effect of China's rise for Africa. We spoke about the awakening of Africa since 2000, so rate growth that used to amount to 5% since 2014, but this is mainly due to the Chinese demand in terms of hydrocarbons, in terms of raw materials, and how China has become essentially the workshop of the world. What matters most is that by the time China was compelled to become more mature, to reduce its growth rate, to bring it to 7.8, 7.9, 7.5, by the time it has launched the strategy of the road and the belt, it has put in place a new strategy with Africa, namely in Johannesburg in December 2015, with two essential proposals, first of which has to do with the transfer of the capital of assistance and investment of $60 billion, and the second and is more important from a qualitative point of view, the possibility of outsourcing a certain number of industries and to adhere with Africa to the logic of cost of production. All this is calling upon us as Africans, Mediterraneans, Moroccans, Maghrebians, Arabs, and Europeans, because their response to this fact, which is today Chinese, tomorrow might become Indian, without overlooking the due interest given by Japan to Africa, all this calls upon us to come up with a collective response throughout the region. One which involves, firstly, the renewal of the European approach for both the Mediterranean and for Africa, involving the integration of some bilateral partnerships, such as the French partnership in Africa,
within a European logic for political considerations, but also from an economic point of view, as well as strategically speaking.
It implies as well
that the relations between Europe, Africa, and the Mediterranean
en matière alimentaire,
adhere to the logic of co-production in terms of training, in terms of industrialization, in terms of agriculture, industrialization having to be global. It's also important that with China and with other countries such as India, we develop a triangular approach on seminal issues such as the issue of food, as pointed out to by Mr. Tarab the day before yesterday. That means that Africa could become a space of competitiveness, but also a space of triangular partnership. And this is what's going to give impetus to the endeavor of bringing back the centrality, past centrality to our region. The third tendency pertains to the whole world, but we're keenly interested in it as people who belong to those geographical spaces. The world is becoming digital, robotized, globalized, but it is composed of human societies that advocate their cultures, their peculiarities, their religions, their historical belongings and historical identities, because these ingredients are key ingredients if one strike the balance and keep equilibrium within society. So we need to then move to the management of a cohabitation between modernity and globalization and the depths of the historical, cultural specificities. Societies need to return to those depths, to those identities, and we need to be quite understanding. For us Muslims, we have a duty. An effort has to be deployed at this level to live our Islam in serenity and quietness, taking into consideration that we need to live it in the 21st century, an Islam of tolerance, an Islam of openness onto modernity, and an Islam of cohabitation and peace, and that has been our eternal quest to develop in this country, thanks to the role played by our king and with the place given to the monarchy. The true jihad is not the jihad of the terrorists, nor is that of the radicalized. The real jihad is an authentic effort that we need to make vis-à-vis ourselves, a jihad that should bring us to do work of jurisprudence and updating, allowing us to make use of spirituality and put it to the service of modernity. And this is what shall allow us to negotiate our cohabitation in this world with the others, with the other cultures, with the other religions, with the other civilizations, allowing them to also recognize our input. There are plenty of indicators as to the world of tomorrow as being necessarily multipolar, but not only that, on an economic and strategic level, but also in terms of the spiritual input, multipolarity that recognizes and affirms the great civilizations, the Western one, with all its components, taking into consideration its history, but also Asian civilizations with their key components and histories, the Arab Muslim civilization with its key components and its histories, and of course the African civilization. This is what shall allow us to rehabilitate our Mediterranean, which is the center of the world, and allowing the Mediterranean to recover its centrality.